worship our Savior this morning. Colossians 1 says, Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. And let's say this together. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Let's worship our Savior.
Worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing his power and his love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Oh, tell of his might, oh, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy space. His chariots of wrath, a deep thunder clouds form, and dark is his path on the wings of the storm. Oh, praise him, praise him. Oh, praise him, praise him. Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the light. It streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Oh, praise him, praise him. Oh, praise him, praise him. All hail to the King in splendor enthroned. Glad praises we bring, thy wonders make known. Returning victorious, great conqueror of sin, in Jesus all glorious, our victory will win. Oh, praise him, praise him. Oh, praise.
Solid ground as nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in his name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. matched in all your wisdom. In love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations. Our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, forevermore. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious.
Amen.
Of a thousand burning suns blazing in the heavens, there is only one. He is our God. Who commands the nations, building up and tearing down, silencing his rivals. There is only one. He is our God. We turn away his love and conquer us with kindness. There is only one. He is our God. Yes, he is our God. Holy, you alone are holy, matchless in to the Lamb who was slain, be glory now to the King on the throne, who was and is to come, and to the Lamb who was slain, be glory. Now to the King on the throne, who was and is to come, and to the Lamb who was slain, be glory. Holy, you alone are holy, matchless in your glory. No one is like you.
Pour out our praise for the great things that He has done.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. We'll shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, We pour out our praises, your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord.
Yes, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised. May our bones and our lungs and all that you have created us to be return praise to you. Return constant worship to you. Lord, may our eyes be fixed upon you. For you have made peace by the blood of the cross. And we walk in fellowship with the Most High. What an awesome privilege that is. So, Lord, I pray that this day where we need to lay things down, to surrender, to realize where parts of our flesh have risen up again, we lay that before you. And we ask that your work in us would be complete. May everything that is said and done in this place this day bring you honor and glory. We praise you. Amen. Church, you may be seated. We have a few announcements that we would like to put your way, just the things that are coming up in our body life in the next weeks ahead. And so please take a look at the VCB News.
Hello, Village Church. I'm Brian Schnell, and you are watching the VCB News. Hello, Village Church. I'm Brian Schnell, and you are watching the VCB. Hello, Village Church. I'm Brian Schnell, and you are watching the VCB News. Ladies, increasingly you are being targeted. That's why we have planned this special Ladies Self-Defense class on Wednesday, July 13th. Come and learn safety tips and how to protect yourself. Our very own self-defense expert, James Netzel, will be teaching. Whether you're in high school, college, career mom, or a senior, this class is for you. Sign up with a friend as you'll be working with a partner, but we can also pair you at the event. Childcare is provided with registration. Please register by Sunday, July 10th. Text DEFENSE to the church number. The Primetimers are holding a Mexican fiesta on Friday, July 15th at 6:30 p.m. Tickets are available at the table in the back starting next weekend. The tickets for the event will cost $10 per person. Dinner, music by a mariachi band, and plenty of fun will be had by all. Someone you know will be doing the Mexican hat dance. Are you looking for a place to serve? We have a great opportunity for you. We are looking for a liaison to coordinate Red Cross blood drives that we occasionally host at VCB. If you're interested or you would like to know more information, call the church office or email serve@vcbweb.org. So, wrapping up, Ladies Self-Defense class is coming July 13th. The Primetimers Mexican Fiesta is coming July 15th. The church is looking for a blood drive liaison. Call the office. And one last thing, if you don't mind, it would really help out if you would fill out the connecting card. You'll find a paper copy in your row, or you can text the word CHECK to the church number. Well, that's all for now. I'm Brian, and you've been watching the VCB News.
Good morning, VCB. How are you? Welcome to our church. We'd like to welcome those that are viewing online as well as those who are here in person. If you are visiting and I have missed you, please do fill out the connection card in the pew in front of you so that we'll know you're here, and then you can just drop it in the offering basket when it comes around. We ask you to relax, but not too much. You can participate in our worship service by singing and praising God. Let him have his way in your life. Now, let's pray for our offering. Gracious Father, we're so grateful for the spirit of giving. We know that you love the cheerful giver, and we are so grateful how you use this church financially. Give us wisdom with every penny that is raised to use it to your glory, and we'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, my name is Calvin Dinkins. I'm the director of community life here at the church. It's my responsibility to make sure all you are taken care of. Thank you.
Kids, you're dismissed to Children's Church.
Come and see, look on his mystery, the Lord of the universe, nailed to the tree. Christ our God, spilling his holy blood, bowing in anguish, his sacred head. Sing to Jesus, Lord of our shame, Lord our sinful hearts. He is our great Redeemer. Sing to Jesus, honor his name, sing of his faithfulness, pouring his life out unto
to
Lord of our shame, Lord of our sinful hearts, He is a great Redeemer. Sing to Jesus, honor His name. Sing to Jesus, His is the throne, now and forever. He is the King of heaven. Sing to Jesus, we are His own, now and forever. Sing to the love our God has shown.
Thank you, worship team. That was wonderful. Well, greetings, friends. I want to give a special welcome to those of you who are our guests. My name is David, and for this next little bit here, I'm going to be taking us through a passage from God's Word to hear what God has to say to us today. But before I give that, I've got a couple of things that I want to give to you. One, it's always sad to me when somebody who's been part of our church for a long time leaves, and we actually have a couple who's been part of our church for a long time, and they are moving away out of state. Jim and Lori Adkins are going to be leaving us soon, and we're sad about that. Jim was one of our deacons for about 6 years, and he also headed up the nominating team 1 year and did a great job for our church. So, brother, we are going to be sad to see you guys go. God bless you and your new haunts, all right? Thank you for your service. Yeah. And also, I want to say that if you've been around for any length of time, you know that I don't typically preach about politics, because I always want the Bible to set the agenda for what we talk about in church. You get enough politics from the news, and in fact, some of you get more politics from the news than you get Bible, and that's not a good thing. But there are some issues where Scripture is crystal clear, and one of those is the issue of life. The Bible teaches that each person is made in the image of God, and because of that, we possess inherent dignity and worth. And therefore, it is wrong to willfully and wantonly take the life of another person. It is usurping a right that God has reserved for Himself and only extends to human government in extreme cases like war. So I am rejoicing that our Supreme Court overturned Roe versus Wade this past Friday. Now, this will not bring an end. Let's thank the Lord for that. So this is not going to bring an end to the barbaric practice of abortion, but it will allow individual states to curtail it. Sadly, in our state, probably not going to make much of a difference, but I am encouraged that a number of babies are going to have a chance at life because of this, so praise God. And also, I think it's important to say that we don't just take a stand against abortion, we are also committed to helping women who face an unplanned pregnancy. We partner with Informed Choices, which is a crisis pregnancy center, to provide for their emotional, spiritual, and practical needs. And so we are pro-life in every sense of the term. So this concludes my brief foray into politics this morning. Now let's get to the matter at hand. The dream of every parent is that their children would get along, that there would be family harmony. We want our kids to be BFFs forever, but it always doesn't turn out that way. Sometimes children get jealous of one another or resent one another. Maybe one child gets praised for a good report card and the other doesn't. Or one child receives the red panda toy that the other wanted. Or one child feels that they're doing more chores than the other. Children are sensitive to perceived inequities. The child who feels slighted may lash out at their sibling. We call this sibling rivalry. And parents sometimes exacerbate this by playing favorites with their kids. Now, the greatest story of sibling rivalry in the Bible is that of Jacob and Esau. They're fraternal twins, and the rivalry starts in the womb. Their parents, Isaac and Rebekah, have difficulty conceiving a child, and so Isaac prays for his wife that she would be able to conceive, and the Lord grants her conception. In fact, double conception. Rebecca can feel the boys struggling in her womb, and she's like, what is going on here? She's first-time mom, you know. And so she prays to the Lord in Genesis 25, and God tells her this: two nations are in your womb, and two peoples from within you shall be divided. The one shall be stronger than the other. The older shall serve the younger. And so when the firstborn, or when it comes time to give birth, firstborn comes out and he's just covered with red hair. So they name him Esau, which means hairy. So not the man's name, Harry, like from Harold, but Harry, H-A-I-R-Y. The second comes out and he grabs a hold of his brother's heel. And so they name him Yaakov, or we would say Jacob, which means heel. And in that culture, to grasp the heel was an idiom for cheating. So they basically named their boy Cheater, you know. So you would have, you know, if you'd walked by their home one night, you might have heard Rebecca call out, Harry, heel, it's time for dinner, you know. That was the names of the kids. But the rivalry between them is the stuff of legend. Esau grows up to be a manly man, and he's favored by his dad. Jacob is more of a mama's boy. And one day, Jacob is cooking some red stew. And Esau comes in from the field, and he's famished. He's exhausted. He's like, I've got to have some of that stew. And Jacob's like, well, I'll give you some if you sell me your birthright. And by the birthright, he's talking about that privilege that the firstborn child would get in that culture to be the leader of the clan after the dad passed away. And Esau can only think about his hunger. He's like, what good is it going to do me to have this birthright if I die from hunger? So give me the food and you can have my birthright. And because of this, Esau gets the nickname Edom, which means red. So it's not because he had red hair, although he did, but it's because he wanted that red stew. Now, fast forward a number of years. Isaac is now old. He knows he's going to die, and it's time for him to give the parental blessing on the firstborn, and he's going to establish Esau as the leader of the clan. But Rebekah has other ideas, and so she gets her favorite son to trick Isaac, puts on a disguise, pretends to be Esau, and blesses him instead. And when Esau finds out that his brother stole the blessing, he wants to kill him. And so Jacob has to go on the run. And he goes far away to family living in another land. And they live separately for a number of years. But then in adult life, Jacob comes back. And he and his brother reconcile, kind of, but not really. They continue to live in different areas. Jacob takes up residence in what is today the land of Israel. And in fact, Israel is named after Jacob. That is another name that God gave him. And then Esau, his descendants, become known as the Edomites. And they start living southeast of Judah. So, the Jews are the descendants of Jacob. The Edomites are the descendants of Esau. The rivalry between Jacob and Esau continues well beyond their lives and affects their descendants for more than a millennium, in fact, about a millennium and a half. When the Israelites leave Egypt and they're passing through the wilderness to go to the promised land, they ask Edom if they can cut through their land, and Edom denies them passage. And so Israel has to go around the long way through the desert. Israel and Edom are often fighting with one another for control of the Gulf of Aqaba so that they can do shipping and that kind of a thing. The Bible tells us that Saul and then David fought against the Edomites and subdued them. But at different times, Edom would get their freedom. Under Jehoshaphat, Edom was subservient to Judah. But then they gained their independence under Jehoshaphat's son Joram. This is a little interesting tidbit. In the New Testament, when Jesus is born, the king of Israel at that time was Herod the Great. Herod was not a Jew. He was an Edomite. He was a descendant of Esau. He had converted to Judaism to become the king of the Jews. Now, despite the rivalry between these two nations, the Old Testament nevertheless teaches the Israelites should treat the Edomites as their kin. Listen to what Deuteronomy 23:7 says. You shall not abhor an Edomite, for he is your brother, the law says. The prophet Amos says something similar in his book, Amos 1:11. So the Edomites are essentially the cousins of the Israelites, and they should have been friendly toward one another. They should have had each other's backs. Now, why am I rehearsing all of this biblical history? Because it forms the historical backdrop for the tiny book of Obadiah, which we are studying today. We won't get what Obadiah has to say about Edom unless we know the history between the two nations. So go ahead and turn to the book of Obadiah. I won't blame you if you can't find it right away. It's just a little tiny book. It's on page 933 of my Bible. Maybe that'll give you at least get close. It's right before the book of Jonah. Obadiah is without a doubt the most neglected book in the Bible. The website Bible Gateway has over 200 versions on there that you can read for free. And they ran some analytics and they found that the book of Obadiah is the least read book in the Bible. It doesn't matter what version it is. Now, there are several reasons for this. One, it's in the Minor Prophets, which are neglected in general. Two, most people are unfamiliar with the historical context that I just gave you, and so like they just have no clue what Obadiah is talking about. Three, it doesn't have really any practical application. And four, it's just one chapter, and it's easy to miss. Blink, and you miss it. In fact, it's the only one-chapter book in the entire Old Testament. So, honesty in church, how many of you would say, I've never heard a sermon on Obadiah? Raise your hand. I had to raise my hand last night because I hadn't heard one either until I preached it. So we are going to remedy that today, all right? We are going to reaffirm the truth of 2 Timothy 3:16 that all Scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable. God has something for us here today. Obadiah is a scathing indictment of Edom. The prophet prophesies doom for the descendants of Esau. Now, we're going to get into the particulars in just a moment, but the basic issue that we're confronting here is pride. The Edomites exalted themselves, and now God is going to humble them. And this is in keeping with what Jesus said, whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted, Matthew 23:12. Peter echoes this when he says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you. So we see this principle fleshed out in the book of Obadiah. So that's going to serve as the structure for this sermon. I've got two main points, and each of them have two subpoints. The title of the message is Obadiah, Humbling the Proud. So our first point is God humbles the proud. You know, pride gives us a distorted view of ourselves. Perhaps God blesses us with some ability or a situation that gives us success in one or more arenas. And so when that happens, it is easy for us to get up on our high horse and to think that we are someone special. We can become intolerably arrogant. And when that happens, we're setting ourselves up for a fall. So let's look at the verdict. This is exactly what happened to Edom. We're going to see the verdict first, actually, in verses 1 through 9, and then we're actually going to find the indictment in verses 10-14. This is kind of a reversal of the way things normally go. In our court system, you have the indictment first and then the verdict later, but God is going to do that in reverse. So let's start reading in verse 1. The vision of Obadiah. Thus says the Lord God concerning Edom. We have heard a report from the Lord, and a messenger has been sent among the nations. Rise up, let us rise against her for battle. Behold, I will make you small among the nations. You shall be utterly despised. The pride of your heart has deceived you, you who live in the clefts of the rock, in your lofty dwelling, who say in your heart, who will bring me down to the ground? Though you soar aloft like the eagle, though your nest is set among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord. If thieves came to you, if plunderers came by night, how you have been destroyed. Would they not steal only enough for themselves? If grape gatherers came to you, would they not leave gleanings? How Esau has been pillaged, his treasures sought out. All your allies have driven you to your border. Those at peace with you have deceived you. They have prevailed against you. Those who eat your bread have set a trap beneath you. You have no understanding. Will I not on that day, declares the Lord, destroy the wise men out of Edom and understanding out of Mount Esau? And your mighty men shall be dismayed, O Teman, so that every man from Mount Esau will be cut off by slaughter. Wow. Tell us what you really think, Obadiah. Let's talk a little bit about the author. Obadiah is actually a common name in Scripture. It means servant of Yahweh. There are at least 12 individuals that have that name, and we don't know which of them is this author or whether this author might be the 13th person. We're just not sure. The prophet throws the brick through the window in the first verse. God, the sovereign ruler of the universe, is sending out an angelic messenger to the surrounding nations to stir them up against Edom. Yahweh wants the other nations of the world to gang up on Edom. Why? Well, as I mentioned, he's going to give us the indictment in a minute, but right now he's going to continue with the verdict. So we have to kind of live with the suspense. In verse 2, God directly addresses Edom, and it is not a positive and encouraging message, but it is one of gloom and doom. He declares that God declares that he is going to make Edom small. And so this means a loss of population and or territory. And he declares that Edom will be despised. The word means to make of little worth or to undervalue. So the other nations are no longer going to respect Edom. They're going to look down upon them as weak and powerless. In verse 3, we find out, as has already been mentioned, that the root issue is pride. The Edomites think of themselves more highly than they ought. They are self-deceived. And that word for deceived there could also be rendered seduced. Now, how did this happen? How did Edom get into this spot? Well, it has a number of things going for it. Let's get our map up here. Let's see, there we go. So just for reference, there's Jerusalem right in the center of that circle. There's the Dead Sea. And here is Edom just southeast. And so it's still doing something here, Jim. There we go. So anyway, the point is that there is this, it's right on the edge of the Jordan Rift Valley, and so it has this long cliff line that where the heights of the cliffs like go up to like 5,700 feet. We've got a picture of that too. And so they were like living up on the top of these cliffs, and it was actually fertile because it was high ground, like kind of the moist air from the Mediterranean would come in and would catch that water. So that whole strip of land was very fertile, and they had vineyards there and whatnot. And so because of this, they have this sense of security. Hey, we're way up on these cliffs. Nobody can assail us from here. The only way that you can get to us is from the kind of like the southern slope, and we've got that really well guarded with fortresses and soldiers. And so nobody can touch us up here. We're invincible. Now, on top of that, they control an important trade route that goes north and south there because people don't want to go through the Arabian Desert. And so they collected tolls on all that trade. You know, so Illinois was not the first to come up with toll booths. You know, they had this back 2,500 years ago. And so they were making all this money from that. And then to boot, the king and his cabinet were renowned for their wisdom. They were men of insight and they governed well. And then they had alliances with the other nations around them, which made for peace. And peace typically leads to prosperity. And so Edom is strong. But it fostered in them a spirit of pride. And God quotes an imaginary Edomite in verse 3 who speaks on behalf of his people, "Who will bring me down to the ground?" And then God says this in verse 4, "Though you soar aloft like the eagle, though your nest is set among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord." That is chilling. And also, there's a little bit of hyperbole here. I mean, you know, eagles don't soar up in the stars. But God's point is, it doesn't matter how high you are. You're not higher than me. I can get you, even in your lofty place there. As King Nebuchadnezzar is going to say later in Daniel 4:37, those who walk in pride, he is able to humble. When God is for us, no one can stand against us. But the converse is also true. When God is against us, no one can stand for us. So God is undermining their sense of security. In verses 5 to 6, he goes after Edom's wealth. Marauders are going to come and plunder their possessions. And even the treasure that they've buried for safekeeping is going to be discovered and found. Nothing is going to be left behind. Edom is going to be stripped clean. In verse 7, God goes after Edom's political alliances. Their supposed allies have turned against them and have attacked them and dispossessed them from their land. And this treachery is going to be sudden and shocking. Edom is not going to see it coming. In verse 8, God goes after Edom's intelligentsia. The wise men are going to be killed or captured, resulting in a significant brain drain. And this is not only going to hurt Edom's prestige among the nations, it's even going to hurt their future chances of survival. In verse 9, God goes after Edom's military might. Their bravest warriors are going to run screaming like little girls, and then they're going to be slaughtered. That word slaughter is used in other texts for the cutting up of a calf into pieces. In other words, we would say butchering. They're going to be butchered. So not only the geeks, but also the jocks are going to be affected. Now that is quite a verdict. It's a veritable death sentence for a nation. And God leads with that. What had they done to merit such a terrible judgment? Well, in the next 5 verses, we finally get the indictment. So let's start reading in verse 10. "Because of the violence done to your brother Jacob, shame shall cover you, and you shall be cut off forever. On the day that you stood aloof, on the day that strangers carried off his wealth and foreigners entered his gates and cast lots for Jerusalem, you were like one of them. But do not gloat over the day of your brother and the day of his misfortune. Do not rejoice over the people of Judah in the day of their ruin. Do not boast in the day of distress. Do not enter the gate of my people in the day of their calamity. Do not gloat over his disaster in the day of his calamity. Do not loot his wealth in the day of his calamity. Do not stand at the crossroads to cut off his fugitives. Do not hand over his survivors in the day of distress." And when we read this, we know why God's so upset. Because this is talking about the destruction of Jerusalem in 586 BC at the hand of the Babylonians. And this becomes the darkest chapter in the sibling rivalry between Jacob and Esau. We've talked about this recently, about how the southern kingdom of Judah had gone into idolatry, pagan idolatry, and they were practicing pagan immorality. And God had warned his people repeatedly through the prophets to repent of their sins and to worship him alone, but they refused to do it. So God raised up Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon to chastise his wayward people, and Jerusalem was besieged for many months. I think it was like 18 months until the people inside the walls were starving to death. And then finally, Babylon's men breached the wall. And King Zedekiah of Judah gathered some of his men and tried to make a break for it under cover of darkness. They tried to get away, but they were caught on the plain, 2 Kings 25. And they weren't the only fugitives who tried to escape. The city was burned with fire. The temple was destroyed. And the surviving Jews were killed or taken captive back to Babylon. It was a terrible defeat for the descendants of Jacob. But this is where Edom comes in. While Babylon was doing all the dirty work, the descendants of Esau began to line up outside like vultures ready to take a bite out of the carcass. They did not help their brother Jacob, but they merely watched as the Babylonians despoiled Jerusalem. And rather than being sad for the Israelites, they gloated. They rejoiced. They boasted over the Jewish people's misfortune. And in fact, Psalm 137, verse 7, records the taunt of the Edomites. Listen to this. "Remember, O Lord, against the Edomites, the day of Jerusalem, how they said, 'Lay it bare! Lay it bare down to its foundations.'" In other words, destroy the city. Flatten every house, flatten every wall, put it right down to the ground again. And then once the Babylonians left, the Edomites swooped in and helped themselves to what was left over. And they moved into people's homes and took their land. They personally profited from Judah's demise. Now, you want to talk about kicking somebody when they're down. And if that weren't bad enough, Edom took it one step further. They set up roadblocks. And if they caught Jewish people trying to flee, they would capture them and hand them over to the Babylonians. And do you know what that meant? That meant death or exile. I mean, it was like those European nations during World War II. Obviously, many people tried to help Jewish people and tried to help them escape. But there were others who turned them over to the Nazis, to their deaths. Needless to say, God was not pleased with this. He says in verse 10, "Because of the violence done to your brother Jacob, shame shall cover you, and you shall be cut off forever." By referring to the Israelites as your brother Jacob, it makes it all the more personal and all the more heinous what they did. So that is why God is so upset with Edom. The Edomites were proud for a number of reasons. They had security. They had wealth. They had wisdom. They had military might. They had political alliances. And they trusted in all of those things. And yet their trust was in the wrong objects. God is greater than all of those things. And compared to him, they are nothing. The Bible warns us about the dangers of pride. Pride is self-deceptive. It leads us to believe that we are something when in fact we are nothing. Proverbs 16:18 says, "Pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall." And we have some historical examples of this from the Bible in 2 Chronicles 26:16. It says that King Uzziah grew proud to his destruction. And then 2 Chronicles 32:25 says of an otherwise good king, Hezekiah, "His heart was proud, therefore wrath came upon him and Jerusalem and Judah." Pride is insidious. It's one of those things that comes so easily from our sinful hearts, and we are often blind to it. We don't even realize that we're becoming proud. We can become proud of our intelligence. We can become proud of our physical prowess. We can become proud of our wealth. And yet God says in Jeremiah 9, let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast in his might. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. But let him who boasts in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who practices steadfast love, justice, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, declares the Lord. I quoted 1 Peter 5 at the beginning, clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another, for God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you. So how do you know if you're proud? You know, it seems kind of an odd thing to say, well, I'm a really humble person. You know, I'm so proud of my humility. That doesn't really work. So here are some diagnostic questions for us to ponder. What percentage of our thoughts are about self versus others? Are you able to put the needs of other people ahead of your own needs? Do you actually listen to what other people are saying to you? Or are you thinking about what you're going to say next and you wish this person would shut up so that you can say what you want to say? Do you engage in self-promotion, whether at work or among your friend group or on social media? Or do you talk about the accomplishments of others and rejoice with them? Do you think that you are better or more interesting than other people? Or do you consider them better than yourself? Do you have to be the center of attention? How do you respond when you're in a group and someone else is the center of attention? Do you get resentful about that? Do you envy them for that? Do you believe that in order for a job to get done right, you have to be the one to do it? Or can you delegate things to other people and trust them to do a good job? When you do something nice for another person, do you have to let them know how much you suffered to do it or how much it cost you? Or can you do something nice with no recognition, no thanks, no reward? You do it anonymously because you don't care about getting the credit. Do you feel entitled to certain treatment? And how do you respond when you don't get that treatment? What gives you your sense of security? Your job? Your house? Your money or possessions? Or God alone? How'd you do? I think I was clipping along at about 50% there. If this exercise revealed that you may be more proud than you thought you were, then we need to repent of that just like we would any other sin, and we need to do what's right. You know, the preeminent virtue in the New Testament is to love other people. But we can't love other people if we're proud because it's all about us. Love is inherently others focused. If we're proud and we only love ourselves, that is a stench in the nostrils of God. And it's a stench in the nostrils of other people too. I mean, that's kind of the damning thing about pride. Like, we don't see it in ourselves, but other people do. They see it. Humility, on the other hand, is a virtue. It is beautiful in the sight of God and in the eyes of other people. So we need to be wary of pride in our life. Here's a dangerous thing to do. Ask someone you trust, do you think I'm proud? Ask your spouse or a parent or a child, a grown child, or somebody in your growth group, and then brace yourself for the response. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11, if we judged ourselves, we would not be judged. You know, I wouldn't like to find out that I'm proud, but if I am, I'd rather know now so that I can do something about it than to find out on Judgment Day and have to answer for it. At least now I've got a chance to make it right. God humbles the proud. And I don't want that to happen to me, and I don't want that to happen to you. And this brings us to our second point. It's the flip side of it. God exalts the humble. Thankfully, the book of Obadiah is not all gloom and doom. The last six verses actually contain hope for the Jewish people and for us. And this point's going to come more quickly. So let's start by talking about the downfall of Edom. So even though Israel's situation seems hopeless at this time, they're dispossessed from their land, they've lost everything. Nevertheless, Obadiah foresees a day when God is going to bring them back to their land, to the land of Israel, and they are going to defeat the descendants of Esau and other nations. So let's start reading in verse 15. For the day of the Lord is near upon all the nations. As you have done, it shall be done to you. Your deeds shall return on your own head. For as you have drunk on my holy mountain, so all the nations shall drink continually, and they shall drink and swallow and shall be as though they had never been. But in Mount Zion there shall be those who escape, and it shall be holy. And the house of Jacob shall possess their own possessions. The house of Jacob shall be a fire, and the house of Joseph a flame, and the house of Esau stubble. They shall burn them and consume them, and there shall be no survivor for the house of Esau, for the Lord has spoken. Verse 15 mentions the day of the Lord. This is a phrase that pops up frequently in prophetic literature. It refers to the time when God is going to come to earth one day and make everything right. He's going to exact vengeance on those who do evil, and he is going to vindicate the righteous. Now, when Obadiah says that this is near, he's not saying that it's going to happen tomorrow or the next day, because in fact, this was like 2,600 years ago. It still hasn't happened yet. So then what does he mean when he says that it's near? Well, it means at least two things. Number one, it's certainly going to happen. This is going to happen one day. And number two, once it happens, like once these events go into motion, it's going to happen swiftly. And so once the Lord returns to this earth, our fate is going to be set at that point. There is going to be no more opportunity to make amends. And so there's a sense of foreboding that comes with this. Like, if I'm not right with the Lord, you know, I need to make that right before he comes, because he could come at any time. That's what he's doing there. The day of the Lord will be a day of wrath. Verse 16 talks about how the Edomites got drunk on the Temple Mount, celebrating the fall of the Jewish people. And that enraged the Lord, that his holy mountain would be for carousing and that kind of a thing. But then he flips the metaphor and he says that the nations are going to do a type of drinking too. And it's the cup of God's wrath. And they're going to keep drinking it and drinking it and drinking it to the point of oblivion. But it's going to be different for the descendants of Jacob. They are eventually going to be freed from their captivity. And they're going to return to the land of Israel, and they're going to repossess it. And the walls of Jerusalem are going to be repaired, and the temple will be rebuilt, and Yahweh will once again be worshipped there, and then Israel is going to conquer Edom once and for all. And sure enough, we look at history, and all of these things happened. In 553 BC, about 30 years after this was written, Nabonidus, the king of Babylon, came and conquered Edom and annexed it and made it part of his kingdom, and they lost their sovereignty at that point. And then in 312 BC, the Edomites were defeated by the Nabataeans to the point that they had to leave their land and go of all places to Judah, and they took up residence in Judah. But then during the Maccabean period, the Jewish leader John Hyrcanus forcibly converted all of the remaining Edomites and had them circumcised and made them Jewish people. And then the Romans came in and they took the former territory of Edom and they changed it to the Roman province of Idumea. And that was the end of the Edomites as we know them. But wait, there's more. Not only is Israel going to return to their land, they're going to expand their territory. Look at verse 19. Those of the Negev shall possess Mount Esau, and those of the Shephelah shall possess the land of the Philistines. They shall possess the land of Ephraim and the land of Samaria, and Benjamin shall possess Gilead. The exiles of this host of the people of Israel shall possess the land of the Canaanites as far as Zarephath, and the exiles of Jerusalem who are in Sepharad shall possess the cities of the Negev. Saviors shall go up to Mount Zion to rule Mount Esau, and the kingdom shall be the Lord's. Let's get our map up there again. I'm going to try this. Hopefully this will work. Let's see. Okay. So again, here is the Negev. And so that is just inhabited by like nomadic peoples. But Obadiah predicts that they're going to come and conquer Edom. And then he talks about how the people of Israel are going to conquer the Philistines over here on the coast. And they're going to take back Ephraim and Samaria, which basically corresponds to the northern kingdom of Israel that was conquered by the Assyrians in 722 BC. And then Benjamin's going to come over here and conquer Gilead on the other side of the Jordan River. And then they're even going to extend up here to Zarephath, which is near to Sidon. That's like modern-day Lebanon. But then the one that really takes the cake, and it's off the map, is he talks about Sepharad. And we know that a group of Jewish exiles made their way all the way north to the modern country of Turkey. And they set up there, maybe you've heard of Sephardic Jews, you know, that's that concept. And he's saying they're going to come back from their exile and they're going to come back to the Negev. And so basically, it's just like a big circle. So with Jerusalem at the center, they're just going to expand their territory and go out. The last verse ends with a promise of deliverance. Saviors, plural, shall go up to Mount Zion to rule Mount Sinai. Now, that could just be rendered deliverers. It's not talking about it in terms of like spiritual salvation, but it's talking about like physical deliverance, like the judges, you know, from the Old Testament, the prophets, we've seen some of those stories of deliverance, the kings of Israel delivering. So he sees a succession of human rulers who are going to bring Israel back to what it used to be. But then notice how the book ends. The kingdom shall be the Lord's. God is going to establish his rule and reign over a reconstituted Israel. Now, the emphasis that Obadiah places on inheriting the land seems a bit foreign to us, like almost even imperialistic. Like, why are they so hung up about the land? But for the Jewish person, that's a big deal. I mean, that's the land that God promised to them. That's their place in the world. That's their inheritance. I mean, imagine how you would feel, you know, if your parents passed away and you went for the reading of the will and you found out that some stranger, like, got all your inheritance. Be like, say what? I mean, there would be such a sense of, like, wrong in your heart, a sense of injustice. And if you can grasp that, then that's a sense of like how the Jewish people feel about their land. Now, maybe you're in a spot right now. God's got you in a spot where you are beaten down. It's been one bad thing after another in your life. And whatever pride you may have had, it is long gone. You are chastened. You're embarrassed. You're discouraged. If that's you, this text has hope for you because our God exalts the humble. He can take someone who's broken and build them back up again, even if the reason for the breaking was chastisement for sins committed. When you turn to God in humility, he wipes the slate clean and he gives you a fresh start and he can even restore what you've lost. Now that restoration may happen in this life. It may happen in the next. Like Obadiah, we believe that the day of the Lord is near. And even though we've been waiting for thousands of years, like that's just a couple days in God's economy, I am betting my eternal future on the fact that one day Jesus Christ is coming back to this earth in bodily form, and he is going to drive out everything that is evil, and he is going to establish the righteous. He is going to reward his people, and we are going to live with him forever. You know, the Messiah came the first time to suffer and to die for our sins. He's coming the second time to rule and to reign. And then the end of verse 21 will literally be fulfilled. The kingdom shall be the Lord's. It is going to be like the Garden of Eden 2.0. We are going to experience life the way God originally designed for us to experience life. So there is a future for God's people, even after judgment. And this shows the mercy of God, and it shows the faithfulness of God. Even though Israel had forsaken him, he was still faithful to them. And even though we go through the vicissitudes of life, God is faithful to us as well. And there is a future for us. God exalts the humble. Several years ago, the Freakonomics blog had a podcast about the Space Shuttle Challenger. If you're old enough like me, you remember. I remember right where I was when I heard the news about that. On January 28, 1986, NASA was planning to launch the Space Shuttle Challenger from the Kennedy Space Center. The mission had attracted a great deal of public interest because there was going to be a civilian on board, a school teacher named Krista McAuliffe. The launch had already been delayed. But NASA officials were antsy. They had go fever. They really wanted to get that shuttle launched. But one of the engineers, Alan McDonald, had serious reservations. He was concerned about how cold it was that day. It was unseasonal. Even though it was January, it was still Florida. But the temperatures were near freezing. And he was afraid that the O-rings on the rockets wouldn't hold up in the cold. So he recommended that they postpone the launch until the temperature warmed up. NASA officials overruled him, and they wanted him to sign off on the launch to say that he thought it was okay. And he refused to do so. And so they pressured his boss, and his boss signed off on it. The Challenger launched the next morning, and then 73 seconds after launch, it burst into flames, killing everyone on board. And the cause of the explosion was exactly what McDonald had feared. The O-rings had failed to hold their seal. So NASA was warned, but they pushed on anyway. Why? According to McDonald, they fell prey to the oldest and most basic sin: pride. NASA had had such a string of success, they just couldn't imagine that they would fail. That pride killed seven people and wounded the collective conscience of the nation. It bears repeating Proverbs 16:18. Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Jesus says, "Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted." We need to be on the lookout for pride in all of its forms. And when we find it in our hearts, we have to put it to death. And we have to embrace instead the godly virtue of humility. We will never become like Jesus if we're proud, because he was humble. Let's pray. Our Father, we recognize that we are proud by nature. It is so easy for us to think that we are something just because we have a little bit of success or things go well for us. And Lord, we fail to recognize that those are actually blessings from you. We think that we've brought them about. And so, Lord, forgive us for trying to take credit for your good work in our lives. Father, I pray that you would touch our hearts with your Holy Spirit, and that you would reveal to us anything in us that is proud and selfish. Father, would you pour out through your Spirit a genuine humility in us so that we will see others as being more significant than ourselves. Help us to be like your Son who came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Help us to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters in Christ. We ask this in his name. Amen.
Let's stand and sing to the one who touches hearts and changes lives.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Song. You know, this concludes our service, but we are going to have some of our leaders down front. This is our practice afterward, and I would just encourage you, you know, to come up and talk with them. For one reason, like, they're really nice guys, and they're people of substance, and so it would just be good for you to get to know them in general. But if you're newer to our church, I think it would be good for you to get to know the leaders, and also if you have any questions about our church, what we believe, what we practice, or anything like, or how to get plugged in, they can certainly help you with that. Maybe you're carrying a burden of some kind and you want prayer. The elders can do that. Or maybe there's a difficult situation you're facing and you just want to get somebody that's got a spiritual perspective to chime in on that and give you some wisdom. They can do that also. Or maybe you have questions about what it means to be a follower of Jesus and how to become a Christian. They can also help with all of those things. So just for whatever, if you have any kind of need at all, please feel free to come forward and to meet these men. Otherwise, if you're good, I would encourage you, don't just run out the door. You know, make a friend today, meet somebody, and whether you're new or you've been here a long time, meet somebody new and get to know each other a bit, okay? God bless you. As you go out this week, I pray that all of us would be looking through this grid of pride and humility, and where am I in that, and am I trusting in the Lord and living humbly and reflecting Jesus to the people that I meet? And may that be true of you this week. Go in grace. Amen.